last time. All right, so I gave you kind of a little historical blurb, if you will, on Dedekind loans. So what these are all about, and I'm going to give you a bunch of sort of equivalent definitions, but these are, we've talked about proof of domains. These are the Noetherian proof of domains, and we're going to get something extra that's kind of cool out of them. One of the things that I alluded to, I was talking about Fermat's Last Theorem last time, you don't have UFDs. It turns out that not all Dedekind domains are UFDs, and certainly not all UFDs are Dedekind domains. So these are actually different classes of rings. But Dedekind domains are similar to UFDs in the following sense. In a UFD, one way that you can couch things is you can couch things in a UFD this way. Every proper non-zero principal ideal can be written uniquely as a product of principal prime ideals. Right? Dedekind domains are where you can remove all the principals. Right? It turns out that every non-zero proper ideal can be written uniquely as a product of prime ideals, which may or may not be principal. So let's let me begin this in the following sense. And you will see probably why I call these Noetherian proof of domains. We say that R is a Dedekind domain. If every non-zero ideal of R is okay. So this is one definition for Dedekind domains, that every non-zero ideal of R is invertible. This also translates to every fractional ideal is invertible as well. We'll see that connection in a moment. But one thing that should immediately jump to your mind is this. R is Dedekind. This means that every non-zero ideal is invertible. Invertible ideals are always finitely generated. So in particular, Dedekind domains are contained in the class of Noetherian rings. Every Dedekind domain has a Noetherian. And notice that this is that analog of proof of domain. Because in a proof of domain, what happens is every finitely generated ideal is invertible. Well, if every ideal is finitely generated, you get the notion of Dedekind here. Let me give you kind of a, there are a zillion plus or minus epsilon different characterizations of Dedekind domains in literature. Let me give you some of my favorite. Let R be an integral domain. Number one, R Dedekind, in the sense of previous definition, all finite or all ideals are invertible, all non-zero ideals are invertible. R is one-dimensional. Or less. I'll tell you what I mean by that. The theory and the interval flows. Uh, Some people reserve Dedekind domains to the ones that are just one domain. So here, so what this means is it's integrally closed. That means that everything in the quotient field of this thing that satisfies the monic polynomial over R is already in R. It's Noetherian, so all its ideals are finitely generated, and it's one dimensional or less. Some people reserve Dedekind domains for the one dimensional case. I don't really think that's the proper thing to do. But of course, a zero dimensional Dedekind domain is a field, because any zero dimensional domain is a field. And of course, notice that a field satisfies this, because the only non zero ideal is the whole thing, which is certainly invertible. Number three. Noetherian and R localized M is a Noetherian bidirectional domain. For all M in max spec R. And yeah, not only good enough. Every non-zero ideal non-zero proper ideal of R is a five. Another characterization, just to show you the breadth of this, is if R inside T, if R is an integral domain, and R inside T is an LCM stable extension for any ring containing T, then R power X inside T power X is LCM stable. Actually, a friend of mine, that's the content of his PhD thesis many years ago. So there's a zillion characterizations across the literature. Let me connect up some of these. Proof. Let's see. Partial proof. Let's do one implies two. Okay, so what do we have? We have every ideal is invertible. And we need to get this other stuff. Well, note as all ideals of R are invertible. All ideals are generated. So R is three. So we got that. We're over that one. We also need a one-dimensional and integral closed. How about one-dimensional or less? Well, let's note since all ideals are invertible, R localized in M is a good idea. Because all ideals of this extended up from bottom, they're all invertible. And remember, locally invertible means principal, right? And so, the dimension of R localized in M is less than or equal to 1 for all M in max spec R. And the only conclusion that we can come to is, so mention of R plus Saturn for one. Because if there were ever a stack 0P inside M, then when if that R localized at M, you would have a dimension 2 or greater ring. Because an R localized at M, M would survive as well as the two smaller primes inside there. Also note, Rm has been proposed. For all. Because after all principal ideal domains are closed, or localized in all principal ideal domains. And recall that R this was an old homework problem, right? That I will grade one day. But R is the intersection of R, all these R localized in. And we also know that an intersection of integrally closed domains is an integrally closed domain. Hence, R is closed. So I think we did them all, didn't we? Right, so there we go.
I ask one more question.
Sure.
Do we need to conclude that the dimension of R is exactly equal to one in this group?
No, I'm going to take fields to be that in domains as well.
Okay.
let's see, how about 2 implies 3? We want R as one dimensional or less, Noetherian and integral closed. We want R to be Noetherian and Rm is a Noetherian valuation domain. Well, I think we can make this 2 implies 3. So we've got all this stuff. So R is Noetherian. Noetherian is automatic because actually it's a hypothesis too as well. So no problem there. What about this business about it's a Noetherian valuation domain? Well, we'll see what happens. Those R localized to M is also Noetherian. This is a general statement that if you have any Noetherian ring and you localize it in any set, it's still Noetherian. So that's not a problem. R localized at N is Noetherian, and dimension plus center equal 1. This is by the correspondence theorem, right? So what we need is a Noetherian valuation domain. I claim that in fact it's a principal ideal. All right. So it suffices Oh, by the way, we also know that R localized in is integrally closed. So, to this end, we show, R is local. By the way, in this part of the proof, I'm replacing R localized M with R, and I'm just going to prove this in general for a local ring. Let me point out that R localized M is, of course, local because we localize the maximal ideal. What do we know? We know it's a theory, and we know it's in close. Local means, of course, the theory as well. And I mentioned less than or equal to 1, then R is a PID. So that's what we're going to show here. Let me point out that the fact that R is a domain in the first place, if the dimension is 0 and it's a field, when we're done, it's a PID. So the most interesting case, we can focus on the case of it being dimension 1. Now, let's suppose R has maximal ideal M, A1, A2, An. So I know that my maximal ideal is finitely generated. And X be any non-zero non-unit of M. Let me point out that I want this to be non-zero. If it's a non-unit, R is a local ring, so it has to be contained in the maximal ideal, correct? So if you have any non-unit, it's contained in the maximal ideal. Does anybody know what a key observation is here? So can anybody think about it? So I've just picked a random non-zero element. And again, I'm going to assume that the dimension is equal to 1, field case is already taken care of. If I have a non-zero element or a non-zero non-unit of R, what's the relationship between X and that maximal ideal? It's a rather radical step in the proof. Right, M must be radical of X. And the reason is the radical of X is the intersection of all primes that contain it. Well, certainly M is one of the primes that contains it, so the radical of X is contained in M. But guess what? M is the only prime that contains it. Because it's non-zero, it's not contained in the prime zero, and the sucker is one-dimensional, so there's only one other one. And it's local, so there's only one maximal ideal. So the radical of M is all of... the radical of X is all the ideal of M. So, so there exists M in the natural numbers, such that each generator finds itself in the ideal generated by X, right? Any of these generators of big enough power ends up in there. Just take the maximum among the powers that it takes and just call that M, right? Now, let's let Y be A1, M minus 1, A2, M minus 1, AN, M minus 1. And if you look at M comes Y, oops. Notice that when Y hits A1, it's in X, and when Y hits A2, it's in X, et cetera, et cetera. So this is actually contained in the ideal. And so, M inverse strictly contains R. Can anybody see why that's the case? Or we can assume that. Can somebody see something that's in
y over x?
There you go. If you look at y over x, m times y over x is always contained in ring R. And so we have strict containment here. And so m inverse contains m.
How do we know here that y isn't in the regular
pattern? Well, all you have to do is find a minimal power for each of these, right? So I probably was a little bit slipshod here, but it's certainly true that it's contained in A. So the question is why is not A1 up to AN hidden there? The n minus one. So the question is, why is this not by x? So I guess I should probably be a little bit more careful about this. What we could do is find select X. So I selected X beforehand, right? So actually, let me get back to this. Let me finish this train of thought, and then we'll go back and look at that. So his criticism is this. And this means, of course, that y over x is in m inverse, right? But the question is how do we know so let me get back to this. So we know that M inverse contains M. So I want this to be R. Then is invertible. And hence, principal has R as well. Right. So our only worry is only concern. Is if M and inverse is actually equal to M, anybody see what's going on? As M is finitely generated, as N is a finitely generated ideal, if Y is in, let me call this, if sigma is in M inverse, then TM is contained in M, correct? But this means, anybody know what this means? Since M is finitely generated, Zm is contained in M, Z must be integral. That was our characterization of integrality. There's a finitely generated modules or such as Zm's contained in M. Right? Therefore, M inverse is contained in R since R is integral closed. And this is a contradiction. As in our previous, as in inverse constricted things are.
Where does Zm contained in M come from?
Where does the, what's that now?
Zm contained in M there? Yeah, in that last part of it.
From that. So if you've got Z in.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Everybody okay with that? So we smoothed that part over, but we've still got to go back and fix this roadblock here. So okay, so yeah, I can do this. So to go back to this detail, we know that notice that while for X thing and the inverse of M, right, for sure. If MY equals X, let's suppose that if you've got equality here, then and we're done. Right, because now you've got only one maximal ideal, in fact, only one prime ideal principal, so it's PID, right? On the other hand, the other thing is exactly what we needed. So the other, so if it's strictly contained in X, then Y over X is in an M inverse, but not in R, right? Because you get the strict containment right here. Okay. Any questions on that? How about 3 implies 1?
I got a super quick one.
Sure.
The board that you just barely erased, so we chose a specific M for which XI, so that the generators were in there. And we chose that M to be the maximum exponent of the generators.
Yeah, you could you could do that.
Okay. Sure,
that'll work. 3 and plus 1. So let me look like a 3 and 1 and see what they were. R is Noetherian, and the localization at any prime is a Noetherian valuation domain. We now need to show that every ideal is invertible, right? So in fact, we can assume it's a proper ideal even. So, okay. Right. So notice that for all M in max spec R, I localize M in R localize M is a principal idea. And the reason for this is because R localized at M is an Ethereum valuation domain and hence a PID. So, since R localized at M is a PID, I localized at M has to be, I localized at M has to be principal. So, I is finitely generated. The hypothesis argument theorem, part three. Remember, that's part of part three's hypothesis is the argument theorem. And I is locally principal for all M in my study. And what does this mean? This means that I have invertible. That's one of our characterizations. Given an ideal with finite and generated is locally principal for all maximal ideals in its environment. Okay. Notice I left out four, but let me kind of get you started. I won't go through the details on this because I want to bring up an example for number three. But exercise mostly. Connect up. But for example, suppose so I can use all of conditions 1, 2, and 3 willy nilly because I've shown they're all equivalent. Suppose every ideal of R is invertible. How would I get I to be a product of primes? Well, start with your ideal I. If it's prime, and let me say that it's non-zero in the whole ring. If I is prime, you're done, right? If I is not prime, then I is contained in some prime P1. And so notice that I can get P1, and therefore I, P1 inverse, is contained in R. If I, P1 inverse, is prime, this turns out to be prime, then multiply this by I P1, you get I P1, and you're done. Right? If it's not prime, then it's contained in a prime. And in fact, this is one dimensional, so all non-zero primes are maximal. Now I'll do it again. Right. And this, of course, contains the previous I1, contains I. If this is prime, say it's P3, then I is P1, P2, P3, etc. Now, this process eventually gets you that I is a part of the primes as long as it terminates. How do I know that this process terminates?
Ask you me. Is it because R is Noetherian?
Because it's Noetherian. This gives you an increasing chain primes. Eventually, it has to stabilize, and that'll be where you get your prime ideal classification. Let me point out, I wanted to, this is an example we've seen before, but I think it's important enough to emphasize. If you look at condition three, one of the conditions for Dedekind is R is Noetherian, and the localization at any maximal ideal is a Noetherian valuation domain. It is very, I think it's extremely natural to ask, do you really need Noetherian there, right? I mean, I used it in my proof of three implies one. It is true, but that doesn't mean that I couldn't have proved it better, perhaps. Is there an example of a domain that is not Noetherian, but yet it's localization? But it'll be, so I'll make it even worse for you. So it's not Noetherian, it's dimension one. So it's got some ideals that are not finitely generated, and yet every localization is Noetherian. And the answer is yes, they're all over the place. And they're actually really kind of weird domains. But one of them that we've seen is this one. Start here with R1 level, a local PID. So it's got one prime, let's say P. So just go in, it's take, I don't know, Z localized it to, or any, your favorite, or a power series turning over a field and one variable. It turns out that you can now build R2, and this will be a semi-local, where the prime P splits into, let's say, Q1 and D1. Is this sustainable? Yes, it is. You can now build another extension of this domain where P1 is Q2, P2. And this is also, at this level, this is also a semi-local PID. In fact, at the three level, you've got three primes, and they're all principal. And you keep doing this. R4, at the fourth level. I know this construction actually from, it's famously in Gilmer's book, but I don't know if he's the originator of it, but it's clever. You can always build this way. At the fourth level, you've actually got four primes, this one and these. Now just take the union of these forever. So this goes off into crazy creation up here. And what happens is the maximal ideals correspond to these cubes. These all remain maximal. Like, for example, Q1 didn't exist here, but at the R2 level, it's maximal, and it remains maximal all the way up. After the existence of Q2, it's maximal all the way up. So the maximal ideals are all the principal ideals generated by the cubes. And this bad boy that goes up forever. Now, the bad boy that goes up forever is not finitely generated because, first of all, you don't have these Qs in there, right? But what do you want to generate it with? P1? Well, no, you can't really do that because P1 is actually, P2 actually generates this, right? And so is P1 and P2 enough? No, because now you need P3. And the first three, and so this maximal ideal here is not finitely generated. It's a mess. Right? It's generated by P1, P2, P3 forever. However, if you localize at any of these, and I love these pictures of localizations, because when you localize, the only primes left over are the primes that actually that are contained in the maximal ideal. So when you localize at Q1, what do you get? Well, you just get you get an Noetherian valuation domain here, right? What happens when you localize here? You only get one prime, Q2, because actually this thing right here, notice P1 and Q2, when you localize at Q2, are now associates because Q2 times P2 is P1, right? That's how we built it, right? But when you localize here, P2 is outside of that maximal ideal, so that now becomes a unit in the localization, and Q2 and P1 are associates, right? And so this one is in the theory evaluation domain, and the list just gets longer and longer. When you localize a Q3, then these things all are units in the theory evaluation domain. And if you localize at the big fat bad boy here, that's not Ethereum. When you localize here, this becomes a principal idea. When you localize, what's the generator? Oh, this is your big chance. You can say piece of anything, and you'll be right, as a matter of fact. Because when you localize it here, notice that P is P1 times Q1. The Q1 is outside the ideal, so it's a unit. So these two are the same. They're associates. P1 is this times this, but this is a unit, so these two are associates. This whole chain of things are actually, they're different globally, but once you localize, they're all the same thing. They're all associates. And so this is an example of, yes, indeed, for our number three characterization, you honest to goodness do need to assume that the ring's an Ethereum. Otherwise, some things can go wrong. Let me give you a theorem here that we are going to use later in this quest here. And this is a huge theorem, actually. And I'm not going to prove this theorem now, but I am going to prove it later because it's actually, this comes up all over the place. If R is a one-dimensional Ethereum domain, a one-dimensional Ethereum domain, and P is an overring of R. So you've got your favorite one-dimensional Ethereum domain. If you have any overring of that, then P is also one-dimensional. Yes, so let me say, let me say one dimensional or less, because of course the one silly case would be T might be far to go far. So this is actually an amazing theorem. And the Noetherian is so here's an example. Consider R. This is two-dimensional Ethereum. It's very easy, actually, to give an overring of this. It's not Ethereum. Just like T. And then start doing this crazy graph. And there are many, many ways to do this kind of thing. I think it's not Ethereum. And, you know, constructing that is that, because now if you look at the maximum ideal that's generated by all these monomials and quotients of monomials here, then, yeah, it's not finite generated. So that seems so easy to construct an example. You would think, well, I mean, is there a one-dimensional ring that has a non-Noetherian, a one-dimensional Noetherian ring that has a non-Noetherian overring? The answer is no, right? So this is actually a rather striking theorem. And also, of course, let me point out that if you look at R localized the ideal generated by X, this is one dimension, not two. So it's easy to drop the dimension down in a non-trivial way. We're going to use this theorem here that if you have an overring of one-dimensional Noetherian domain, then it's also one-dimensional Noetherian a number of times, and we will actually prove it later. Let me give you one quick corollary of this, which I think is kind of nifty. And this actually goes to show you how to build these things. If R is one-dimensional and Noetherian, then the integral closure of R is Dedekind. So this is Jim's favorite way of building your own homemade Dedekind domain. Take any one-dimensional Noetherian domain you like, take its integral closure, bang, it's going to be Dedekind. Why is that? Well, because this theorem tells me that when I start with R, one-dimensional Noetherian, its integral closure is one-dimensional Noetherian. And integral closures are integrally closed, so it's Dedekind. So here is another theorem, and this theorem I call algebraic number theory because it's part of the big cog that makes number theory work. So theorem, and I'm sort of giving you a teaser on this a little bit. 5 to 5. If R is Dedekind, the quotient of K and F is a finite extension of K. And of course, what I mean by finite extension is finite dimensional extension. Okay. Then T, the integral closure of R and F, is also Dedekind. Okay, so here's my diagram of this. You start with any Dedekind domain R. It's got quotient field K. You extend this, and you let T be the integral closure of R and F. If this is Dedekind, and that extension is finite, then this is also Dedekind. So we'll prove this next time. Let me point out that we've already done sort of the heavy lifting on this, some of the heavy lifting. Because what do we know? We already know that T is a proofer, because of course any Dedekind domain is a proofer. So we already know that T is a proofer domain, so it will suffice to show that T is Noetherian, right? Because we know it's proofer, so if we can show it's the theory, we'll be done with it. And we will do that next time, which I guess is today, like a weekday. It's like Friday, so you all got fall break, so I hope you enjoy it, and I will see you when we get back.